found out by integrating the period of the signal t tending to infinity 1 by t minus t by 2 to t by t x of t dt. So this, as I told you, integration limits, you can write it as minus t to t and put 1 by 2 t here, or minus t by 2 to t, put 1 by t here. So that the answer will be same, whether you use that limit or this limit, it will be same. So now again, you integrate with respect to time here, okay? So we'll be getting again 0 1. So if the time average is equal to n simple average, the random process is going to be ergodic in nature. And we also discussed in the yesterday's class, okay, morning class, why do we need n simple averages and why it is called wide sense stationary process. A strict sense stationary process means all the moments like mean, variance, kurtosis, and skewness, joint PDF, joint CDFs, autocorrelation, cross-correlation, whatever parameters you take in the random process, okay, they'll all be constant without varying, varying with time, okay, they'll be constant. Whatever the time interval you take, the mean is constant, the correlation is constant, autocorrelation is constant, okay, and all the joint PDF, CDFs, everything is not varying with time. That is called a strict sense stationary process. So we relax and say wide sense stationary process if only the first moment, okay, that is the mean value and its autocorrelation, okay, first moment mean and autocorrelation function. If autocorrelation is depends only on the time difference, and if mean is constant, doesn't matter what time interval you take the ensemble average, whether it is T1 or T2, T3, doesn't matter. You're taking the ensemble average, so that will be constant. So ensemble mean is constant, and autocorrelation function only depends on the time difference, not the actual values of the time where you're taking the samples. So that is called as wide sense stationary process. And we also discussed what is ergodicity, and we took some examples like DC voltage when it is left off for some interval of time. And if you take the average at some time instant t, so that should lead to zero when you repeat the experiment for, say, more number of times or more number of students in this case. And we also told one more thing is when you put a voltmeter, a sensitive voltmeter across a resistor at room temperature, because of the random moment of the electron, they will collide and there is a random noise which is getting generated. If you measure that noise in all the voltmeters, so right now you have written only 3 voltmeters. So if you can repeat that for say 1000 resistors and processors and all, if you take the average of that process, ensemble mean, it will be zero. If you take the time average also, it will be zero. So here the process is ergodic, but here if you take the average, the ensemble average, it is going to be zero. But if you take the time average for only one signal, one random process, if you take, not the ensemble process. So ensemble process average means it is, you have to take all the waveforms, okay, at time, what one instant you have to average it out. If it is time average, you take only one process and you average over the time. Okay, so that is called time average. So we proved that in this case it was not proved to be ergodic, but in the second case it is time mean is equal to ensemble mean, so the process is ergodic. Okay, so is this clear to you? Is the examples whatever we have done yesterday, is this clear? And also we discussed power spectral density. Hello, no response.
Yes sir, clear.
Okay, others please respond. Yeah, others. Only this Harsh is responding every day. What about others? Ishita Sharma, Janardhan Gowda, Junaid Khan, Shreya. Are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so yesterday we said yes, power spectral density is very, very important parameter. From that I can find out what is the content at frequency zero, whether some information is there at zero, okay, and what is the bandwidth of the signal, and where to sample the signal. If you want to sample the signal, where can I sample? I need to sample where the signal has got a more power, right? So where the signal has got more power, I need to sample. So from power spectral density, I can find out. So if I have power spectral density Sx of F, something like this, I can sample exactly at 1 by T, where the power is maximum. I want to find out, I want to sample here. Why? Because if I sample it when the power is maximum, signal to noise ratio is going to be maximum. If I sample somewhere here, okay, let me put somewhere here, if I sample, say 1 by 2 T, okay, then here at this point, the signal to noise ratio, signal power is less. So if I compute signal to noise ratio, then it will be less on. So that is the reason why we want to sample exactly at the peak. How do we get this peak? Only if I plot power spectral density, then I'll be getting this peak values. I'll be finding out the bandwidth and all those things. Okay. So this is by using spectrum analyzer, I can plot this in practice by using spectrum analyzer. Okay. So we said that PSD of x of t, we said it's multiplication. If I want to find out power spectral density, it is if I have the Fourier transform, the signal truncated Fourier transform. That is, we multiply a rectangular pulse with some periodic signal, it will become a truncated aperiodic signal. So this is truncated signal, which is aperiodic. So if I multiply a rectangular pulse and sine or cosine, so I'll be getting so much truncated signal. Then in the mathematics, we write, okay, xt of t is equal to x of t multiplied by rectangular pulse. Then if I have autocorrelation, from that also I can find out power spectral density by taking the Fourier transform autocorrelation function. Or if you have PSD, from that if you want to find out autocorrelation function, you can take inverse Fourier transform. So some of these things we discussed yesterday. And power also, we found out that it is a mean square value of the signal will give the power. Okay. And we also did one some small example. Okay. So is this clear to you, all of you? Others, please respond.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So now we'll do some more examples to understand whatever we have discussed the concepts better. Okay. So let us do some examples, some more examples. Okay. So determine the PSD. Determine the PSD and mean square value. Determine the PSD and mean square value. Okay. Of a random process. Okay. Of a random process. X of t. RP stands for random process. A cos omega c t plus theta. Okay. Where theta is a random variable. Theta is a random variable which is uniformly distributed. Which is uniformly distributed. Distributed over 0 to 2 pi. Okay. So you need to find out the power spectral density of this process. And also you need to find out the mean square value. Okay. So this is very easy to find out. So it is... I think for this, we already found out autocorrelation function for this. Okay. What is the autocorrelation function for this? Yesterday, we have done this same numerical. What is the autocorrelation function for this? We have done yesterday. Autocorrelation function. So yesterday, we have done this numerical. Okay. So this one. A square by 2 cos omega c tau. Same equation, right? AC cos omega c t plus tau. We have done the autocorrelation function yesterday. So I will not repeat this procedure. You can do it because we have done this numerical. So we'll take the result as it is. So S square by 2 cos omega c into tau. So autocorrelation function is depends only on the time difference for this. So try to find out the autocorrelation function. Yesterday we have done this numerical. I'm taking the result as it is. How do you find out the power spectral density from the autocorrelation function? How do you find out the power spectral density from the autocorrelation function?
Fourier transform.
Yes, take the Fourier transform of this. Okay. So if you take the Fourier transform, of course, what is it? Is delta function, right? 1 by 2.
Delta.
1 by 2 will come out. So 1 by 4. 1 by 2 into 1 by 2 is 1 by 4. So it is a delta function. So del of f plus fc plus del of f minus fc. If it was sine, it will be minus over there. Here. That's all, nothing else. If it was sine, there will be minus sine. Okay, del of f plus fc minus del of f minus fc. So we will not be doing one more problem with sine. So you should be knowing what is the Fourier transform. Okay, signals and systems you cannot forget. Okay, so now this is the power spectral density. First you need to find out autocorrelation function that we have done yesterday for the same problem. We can take the result as it is. Okay, you can't mug up this. You have to do this. Okay, we have done this yesterday. Please refer to that. The next is we need to find out the mean square value. So what is the mean square value? It is represented like this. So you square the signal, then take the mean square value. Okay. So what is this? This could be also found out from the RxS when tau is equal to 0. So that is the mean square value or the power of the process. Okay. RxS of 0. What is RxS of 0? That means this is tau, right? Tau is equal to 0. So if cos 0 is going to be 1, so I'll be having a square divided by. They're all simple, very simple questions, like kind of a quiz questions. Okay. where S bar by 2 is the power of the process, and cos factor density is Fourier transform of this. Cos is very easy to take for Fourier transform. Right? So is this clear numerical? Very simple numerical.
Yes.
Yeah. So now let us go for another numerical. Determine the autocorrelation function. We need to find out the autocorrelation function. So determine the ACF, autocorrelation function. When I say ACF, you need to be used to these terminologies. RV means random variable, RP means random process, ACF means autocorrelation function. Okay. So we'll be using this again and again, autocorrelation function. And the PSD, power spectral density of the DSBSC, that is double sideband suppressor carrier. In AM amplitude modulation, have you studied anywhere, at least in basic electronics, some introduction was there?
No, sir. Yes, sir.
In basic electronics, yeah. Communication, you had one unit, no?
Double sideband, I'm not sure without, sir.
No, sir, not this one.
Okay, I'll quickly tell you what is it. Okay, double sideband suppressed carrier. DSBSC, double sideband suppressed carrier. Okay, suppressed carrier. So I will tell you what is this. This is like amplitude modulation only, one variant of amplitude modulation. And PSD of the DSBSC suppressed carrier, DSBSC modulated process, M of t times cos omega c t plus theta, cos omega c into t. Okay, so you should be writing this correctly. Omega c t plus theta, where m of t is a WSS, wide sense stationary random process. So please be clear with the notation, wide sense stationary random process. And theta is a random variable. Theta is a random variable which is uniformly distributed over 0 to 2 pi. And they were given one more statement, and it is independent of m of t. That means it is independent process. M of t and theta are two independent events. So we need to find out this. So quickly let me tell you what is DSBSC. It's a double sideband suppressed carrier. For amplitude modulation, how many sidebands will be there? Amplitude modulation.
Two sidebands.
Okay, basic electronics you learned, at least you remember that because it's required. So this is FC. This is FC plus FM. This is FC minus FM. So you're able to recall, right? In basic electronics, you studied this.
Yes, sir.
This is minus FC. So let me write here as AM. So this is FC. So carrier is there. This is SAM of T. Amplitude modulated signal with respect to. So let me write function here. Frequency F is equal to F. So this is the spectrum Fourier transform of the signal. So this is minus FC. Again, I have minus FC plus FM. Then I have minus FC minus FM. Correct? This is standard AM. Standard AM, amplitude modulated signal. AM stands for amplitude modulated signal. How many sidebands are there?
Two.
Sidebands. Okay. So this is right. The left side you forget because it's only for representation. It won't be existing in practice. Okay. It's only for mathematical convenience writing. This is USB, FUSB. This is FLSB. I'll write it as lower sideband and upper sideband only, just to indicate. So this is LSB, lower sideband. Okay. So two sidebands. How do you define out the bandwidth? FC, the range of frequencies over which this signal is existing.
FC, 2FM.
2FM. Bandwidth of this is 2FM. Okay. So this is standard AM, amplitude modulation. So, and in the amplitude modulation, you have seen that only sidebands are carrying the information. Only sideband carry the information. Carrier is not carrying any useful information. So in AM, we say that only sidebands, both the sidebands. Okay. Actually, only one sideband is sufficient. Okay. So we have in standard N, we have two sidebands, upper sideband and lower sideband. Only sidebands carry the information. Carrier is not carrying any useful information. Okay. If you see this, at FC, we don't have anything. Only FC plus FM and FC minus FM information is present. Carry the information. So that's why what they did, once they discovered this fact, okay, this is all 60s, 50s, 1950s, 1960s, this story, okay. So what they did, they suppressed the carrier. Anyway, carrier is not, after modulation, it is not useful. And this carrier carrying, most of the power is carried by the carrier. If you find out what is the power of the carrier and power of the sideband, 70% or 60% of the power is carried by the carrier only. Only 30% of the power is carried by the sidebands. 70% is wastage power in the carrier, which is not having any useful information. Why to transmit the, why to use the carrier there? For modulation you use, later you can suppress the carrier. Okay. And once we know FC plus FM and FC minus FM, this is sufficient for us. We can suppress the carrier. Then what they did, they came up with DSBSC, double sideband. Both the sidebands are there and with suppressed carrier. So no carrier. After modulation, you suppress the carrier, transmit only FC plus FM, FC minus FM. These two frequencies you transmit. This is say, let me take, this is say, FC is 1 megahertz. This is say 10 kilohertz. You transmit that and FC minus FM. So again, 1 megahertz minus 10 kilohertz, whatever it comes, you transmit only that. You don't transmit 1 megahertz. So it is called as double sideband suppressor carrier. So they were able to save the power. So this is to save the power. Okay. Because carrier was carrying 70% of the power. Sidebands were carrying only 30% of the power in amplitude modulation. So they came up with a technique which is called double sideband suppressor carrier, where the carrier is suppressed and power is saved. Okay. So that is one thing. And later they came to SSB, single sideband suppressor carrier. Okay, DSP, because they discovered again, okay, FC plus FM and FC minus FM, they're carrying the same information. Why to transmit two sidebands? Let us transmit only one sideband. Then it became single sideband carrier. Okay, so it is called single sideband suppressor carrier. This is all amplitude modulation, analog amplitude modulation. Sideband suppressor carrier. Suppressor carrier. So we'll not discuss much about this SSB and all those things, but then later again they modified SSB, then they call it as VSP, vestigial sideband modulation. Vestigial sideband modulation is used in television, sideband modulation. For picture transmission, they use VSP in TV, okay, they use this in TV, use in television for picture transmission, And they use FM for voice transmission. In TV, they use SSB, they use VSB, vestigial sideband, they use for picture transmission. And they use FM for voice transmission in TV. Okay. So there are various reasons why they do all these things. We'll not go into the details. Our interest is to find out what is the perspective density and what is the articulation function of it. So the word came DSBSC, so I have to tell what is DSBSC. DSBSC means it is a double sideband with suppressed carrier. That is the information. Okay. Now let us solve the problem. Now let us indicate, okay, phi of t. Are you able to understand what I'm telling?
Yes, sir.
Cos omega ct plus theta. So we are indicating the given signal only. The given signal, they have given m of t cos omega ct plus theta is a modulated process. So modulated process is indicated as phi of t, some phi of t. You can indicate s of t also. No problem. So now we need to find out autocorrelation function. How to find out the autocorrelation function? So we need to put this t plus tau and check whether we are getting the same result of depending on only on tau, or it depends on the time intervals, or it is depends on the difference in time interval. So how do you do this? So this is m of t. Cos expectation operator you take. So cos omega ct plus theta multiplied by m of t plus tau. Okay. Add the time difference. Cos omega c t plus tau. Wherever t is there, I am adding the time difference plus theta. Okay. So this is bracket. And instead of writing expectation operator, I'll use bar. Bar is basically this expectation operator. What is rxx of tau? Remember, rxx of tau is equal to, what is rxx of t? Can you tell me quickly? What is rxx of t? Expectation of?
Expectation of R of t into R of t.
What, yeah? You have done this, don't forget. What is expectation of t? Rxx of t. Rxx of t, autocorrelation function we have defined. Don't, you should not forget all these things. See, here we have written expectation of x of t1 plus tau. We are comparing the same signal, okay, at two different intervals of time. This, if you remember, it's fine. You can write the equation, but the concept should be clear. X of t1 plus tau. That's all. Okay, two same signal. I'm correlating two different intervals.
So, can you clear that notation? Do we use Rxx or Rx? When to use Rx?
No, both are same. 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 Rxx, Rx, some textbook they'll use Rx, some textbook they'll use Rxx, both are same, equally valid. So this will be expectation of x of t, okay, x of t1, then capital X, okay, x of t1 plus tau. So this is what is the definition. So now we are writing this. Instead of Rxx, we are writing R5 because we want to find out what is articulation for this. So now R5 of t will be equal to, so expectation is bar here. This bar, whatever is there, is a expectation operator. You should be aware of that also, because simply you can't tell, okay, what is the bar notation? It is an expectation operator. And now let me take out this m of t, okay, m of t plus tau, okay. Then, because let me give the reason, theta and m of t are independent. Because theta and m of t are independent, okay, I can mean m of t plus tau, I can separate them. They are two independent. Theta and m of t are independent, okay. So now I can write cos of omega c t plus theta, then cos of omega c t plus tau plus theta, okay. So this, let me put the bracket correctly. I am separating this. Because theta and m of t are independent, okay. Now, what about this? So this will be, if you find out, okay. I think yesterday we have done some numerical. What is the autocorrelation of this again? What is the autocorrelation of this again? Yesterday we have done the same numerical. Omega c t plus theta plus omega c t t plus tau theta. Autocorrelation of cos of omega c t plus tau.
We get omega c t tau. Yeah.
Omega c t tau only. So we'll write, so this m of t plus tau, okay, let me write that as, the 1 by 2 will come here, okay, 1 by 2, then rm of tau, because this autocorrelation between m of t plus tau is rm of tau, then cos omega c, okay, so this representation I'm writing it as rm of tau. Rm of tau means expectation of x of t1 plus tau, the same definition I'm writing it. Definition, instead of writing this, I am writing this. Okay. So this is autocorrelation function of the process, modulated process of DSBSC. This is Rm, okay, Rm of tau. So now we need to find out the power spectral density. So if I know autocorrelation function, it is easy to find out the power spectral density. So power spectral density is given by, again, cos only is there. So if I write it as cos is 1 by 2 times, right, 1 by 2, 1 by 2 will become 1 by 4. So now this Rm of tau multiplied with delta functions. I read it as some other notation. Sm of f plus fc, okay, plus Sm of, okay, Sm of f minus fc. So the multiplication of this Rm of tau with the delta function, I'm writing it as Sm of f plus fc, Sm of f minus fc. So from this, I can find out.
Why Sm?
Different notation, because Sm is basically, here I have S, right, power spectral density. I want to write the power spectral density. So power spectral density is Fourier transform of this autocorrelation function, right? So cos is delta function. So instead of writing Rm multiplied by that, okay, if I take the Fourier transform of this, the notation I want to change it and write, because in the frequency domain, okay, so whatever notation is there, I want to change the notation and write. It will be Sm of f plus fc. It is only notation. Otherwise, there is no significance of writing Sm.
So, and when you take the Fourier transform, why is Rm of t independent of t? R amount of tau is independent of tau?
Yeah, it is. It is actually because when you check this process, M of t only, message signal M of t, if you take the ensemble average, okay, if you take the ensemble average, or let me use the autocorrelation function. Here it is autocorrelation function. If you take the autocorrelation function of the message signal, okay, so it is independent of the time at which you are comparing the message signal. So let us assume have a sinusoidal signal, okay, something like this, sinusoidal signal, okay, M of t. If I have to take autocorrelation function, means what? I have to fix at t1. I mean, I have a process actually, ensemble process. And I'll have one more signal of sine. So if I take all the sinusoidal signals, I compare that value with t and t1. Okay, so t1 and t2. I'm having the I'm getting the autocorrelation function, which is only difference of time, not the actual value of time where I'm taking the process. So that's why I'm writing this entire thing as Rm of tau only. Message signal, they have not told whether it is sinusoidal.
If Rm of tau was also like a cos function of tau,
yeah,
then we could have written the delta function for that also, right?
Yeah, that also we written. We don't know right now. We don't know. They have not mentioned anything.
So how are we dealing with that? How are we dealing?
So
with
right
that?
Now we are writing it as SM only because we don't know what it was.
That is why.
Yes, if it was cos, then cos A cos B, then the cos A cos B relation we would have written. After that, we would have taken the Fourier transform.
And we should take the convolution, right?
Here it is. After convolution only, whatever the equation you are getting, that we are writing here.
That's so SM of F of
SM of F plus FC, okay. SM of F minus FC. Here it is multiplication. When you take the Fourier transform of this autocorrelation function, it becomes a convolution. That final signal we are writing it as SM of F plus FC, SM of F minus FC. Because we don't know what is the message signal behavior.
So we can't hear you.
This tau will become zero. If tau is zero, M
so
square.
We weren't able to hear you, sir.
Hello? Are you able to hear me now?
Now, sir.
No, it's fine.
Yeah. So 1/2 Rm of zero.
Can you repeat, sir? Okay, can you please repeat?
Yeah. After... So this is a mean square value. We want to find out the power of the process. Are you able to understand? Listen to me. Are you able to listen to me? Hello?
Yes, sir. Now you're audible.
Yeah. So now mean square value of this process, if you have to find out, so square the signal and take the average. Or it could also be found out from the R phi of, when you put tau is equal to 0, you can get the power of the process. So R phi of 0 means here, R phi of 0, that will be Rm of tau. Rm of tau, this cos tau when it is 0, it will be cos 0 is 1. So Rm of 0. Rm of 0 means what? So it is Rm of 0 means we need to put tau is equal to 0. So it will become m square t. So it will be 1/2 m square of t, mean square. So mean square value of your message signal, whatever is there, that is the power of the process. That means the power of a DSBSC modulated signal is half of the power of the modulating signal. I can conclude here that power of the DSBSC, double sideband suppressor carrier, modulated signal is half the power of the modulating signal. Modulating signal means M of t. So did you get this mean square value? R phi of 0. R phi of 0 means Rm of 0. Cos 0 is 1. So Rm of 0 means m of t only, mean square value of the message signal. Whatever the power I have got in message, this is power of the message signal. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So this is about the TSD as well as the power of the DSP, double sideband suppressed carrier. Okay. Now let us consider one more example. Okay, where let us prove whether this process is stationary or not. Okay. So let us take one more example. Example three. Okay. So consider a random process x of t, which is a sine omega naught t, a sine omega naught t, and a is a random variable. Amplitude is a random variable because earlier we used to take phi is a random variable. Now a is a random variable, uniformly distributed. Uniformly distributed over 0,1. Over 0,1. Find the mean and ACF, part of correlation function, okay, and check for wide sense stationary process. You have to check for WSS process, okay. Now, how do you proceed now? For the mean value, expectation of this, how do you take the expectation operator of where, which is a random variable?
It is a random variable,
which is uniformly distributed between 0 to 1. So, it is... to 1, it is uniformly distributed. Okay, so this is the PDF of A. So this is 1 because this 0 to 1, it is there, height of this will be 1 only. Okay, uniformly distributed over this. So now you need to find out the mean of this. So quickly find out mu x of t. Mean of this is going to be expectation of x of t. Okay, so expectation of A sine omega naught t. So now only random variable is A. So you need to take expectation operator only for the random variable A, not for sine. Okay. So expectation of A multiplied by sine omega naught t. You are taking expectation only for the random variable, not the determinant signal sine omega naught t. So expectation of A, you need to find out. So what is expectation of A? So it is the value. So this is actually expectation of A. Is minus infinity PDF of A. Okay, so let me write PDF of A DA. Okay, so now this is 0 to 1 because it uniformly distributed. So now its PDF is going to be 1, the height of the PDF is 1, so into DA. So it will be A square by 2, 0 to 1, so it will be 1 by 2. But very easy to find out what is the mean. So this is expectation of A. Now we substitute that here, mu x of t is equal to 1 by 2 times sine omega naught t. Okay, so now you check at t is equal to 0. What is the value? What is the mean at t is equal to 0?
0.
T is equal to pi by 2. That means omega naught t. If omega naught t is equal to 0, it is 0. Omega naught t is equal to pi by 2, 1 by 2. Omega naught t is equal to pi.
Minus 1 by 2.
0.
So now, is it stationary? It is stationary in mean. Stationary means what? Means to be constant.
It's not stationary in mean.
It's not stationary in mean. So this process is not stationary in mean. Because you can check omega naught t is equal to 0, pi by 2, okay, value is not constant. Vx value is not constant. Okay, so that is why it is, the process is going to be not stationary in mean. Okay, Vx value is not constant. Okay. Next is, you need to check for the autocorrelation function, Rx of t1 comma t2 will be equal to, I am writing the definition again and again so that you need to understand, okay? So it is...
I have a doubt.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, when the process is not stationary, you said mean value is not constant, right?
Yeah.
That's the definition. Like when you did classification, you do during stationary that... all the factors like PDF, mean and moment are independent of time, then they are stationary.
No, that is wide sense stationary. Wide sense stationary means mean should be constant, autocorrelation function should be depends only on the time difference. That's called wide sense stationary. Stationary, okay. Stationary means it is all should be constant. That's why we written only in mean it is station, not stationary. Process is not stationary in mean. In mean it is not stationary.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
Understood.
Fine. So now expectation of, I'm taking the two random variables, comparing at two different instant of time. Same random variable x, comparing at two different instant of time. So expectation of, so what is this x of t1, x of t2? That means only time will be different. So it a into a. So this is also a, this is also has got a. So it will become a square sine omega naught t1, then sine omega naught t2. Okay. So it will be only expectation operator should be taken only for a square, no? Because a square, a is the random variable. So if we take expectation operator for a square, so it again you have to integrate 0 to 1 a square dA. So what is a square integration?
A cube by 3.
A cube by 3. What is A?
So shouldn't we take it as A1 and A2?
No. Why? What a correlation function is only at the time difference, only at the time instance. What is the function of time? Sine omega not T1. A is not a function of time. A is a random variable.
Right.
A is a random variable.
Sorry.
Yeah. So 1 by 3 because A cube by 3 will come. If I substitute the limit 0 and 1, it will be 1 by 3 only. So I'm writing that as sine omega naught t plus tau, okay, or t2 is t plus tau basically, or t1 plus tau. So this, if we take it as t and t plus tau, so I can write finally as omega naught t plus tau. So this is clear. Okay, so now if you put this autocorrelation function of t comma t plus tau, so we're writing this as 1 by 3 sine omega naught t into sine omega naught t plus tau. So we're writing it as t1 as t, t2 as t plus tau. This was t1, this was t2. Okay. So if I put that here, t2 and t1 place, I'm getting t and t plus tau. So now, is the autocorrelation function depends only on the time difference or in the time also? Time t1 and t2 also?
We have to combine and check.
Combine and check also. Right now, this is sine omega t, sine omega naught t. They are not random variables, right? They are not random variables, okay? Frequency is not a random variable. Only amplitude is a random variable. So even if you check that, it will be function of t1 and t2 only. If you replace, say, you take this sine A, sine B, okay? Even if you take that equation sine A, sine B, you will have the final autocorrelation function, which will be function of t1 as well as t2. It is not on the time difference. It is depends on the time intervals itself. That's why this is not Yes.
So we have to combine and check first, right?
Combine and check, man. That's what I'm telling.
You're saying after combining, you'll realize that it will not be.
You combine now only. What is sine A? How do you do this? Expectation of operator, anyway, it is only sine A, sine B equation, right? Now, 1 by 3 times sine A, sine B. What is sine A, sine B?
Cos of A minus B plus cos of A plus, minus yeah. Cos of A minus.
Yeah, so plus, yeah. What will have? T1 minus T2, then T1 plus T2. Other term is also there. T1 plus T2 is also there. Not only T1, T2 minus T1. T2 plus T1 is also there now in the equation. That's why that equation depends on T1 and T2, not the time difference tau. If it was only depends on T2 minus T1, then we said, okay, tau is T2 minus T1. It depends only on the time difference, not the time instant itself. So ACF depends on, okay, ACF depends on, autocorrelation function depends on time instance also, not the time difference, time instance T1 and T2. Where you are taking the samples, that time instant also it is a function, autocorrelation function is depends on the time instant itself. So we can say that the random process, okay, given random process is what? What is the conclusion? Is not?
Not white and stationary.
Yeah, not white and stationary. Is it clear? Is it clear to you, everyone?
Yes.
Others, respond. Others.
Yes.
Okay. Next, we'll take one more example. Consider a sinusoid with with frequency, okay, with frequency, sense or signal with frequency F, capital F, is a random variable, which is, now frequency is a random variable, amplitude random variable, phase random variable, that we have done, which is uniformly distributed over interval 0, F0. Frequency is now uniformly distributed. And x of t is given as cos 2 pi capital F t. Capital F is a random variable which is distributed 0 to F0. Okay. So now find the mean. Find the mean. So quickly do it. Yeah, find the mean value. We want the mean value. What is the mean value? F is random variable now. Quickly, can you do it? This is PDF of F. Okay. So 0 to F naught. The height is going to be 1 by F naught. Okay, PDF value is 1 by F naught. So do it quickly. Can you do it quickly and tell me what is the mean value? Hello, you are there?
Solving, sir. One second.
Yeah. You can solve, but at least respond, yeah. Because I am not able to see you. So it is. Yeah, do it. So what will be this integral, right? What is the value of PDF? 1 by F naught. So integral 0 to F naught. PDF is, the signal is cos 2 pi F t. Okay. PDF was 1 by F naught. Integral is over DF. Okay. What do you look at? What will you get? Cos integration. This is with respect to F, remember.
Sine.
Then divide by what?
Divide by 2 pi.
2 pi t.
2 pi t. 2 pi t, sir.
F naught is also there.
F naught is already there, sir.
Yeah, already there. So 2 pi t. Okay. So what is this form? Signals and systems.
Sync function.
Sync of what? 2F0T. Okay. Sync of 2F0T will be sine of 2πF0T by 2πF0. This is sync function. So if you take, you see now, why we have done three different problems. One, amplitude is random variable. Frequency is random variable. Phase is random variable. So if phase is, I think the first case what we discussed. This is phase is random variable. Here. Okay. So we got mean value. Here, if you take the mean value, I think yesterday we have done what was it? We got 0, right? So this one, theta is randomly distributed. We got time mean also, ensemble mean. Yeah, ensemble mean only we are interested in right now. So ensemble mean we got 0. If theta was a random variable, we get mean 0. If amplitude is a random variable, okay, then amplitude is a random variable, we get mean is 1 by 2 sine omega naught t. Okay, mean is not constant again. Mean is changing. If frequency is a random variable, then again you can see at different instant of time, sync will take different values. Sync of 0 is 1. Sync of, say, pi by 2, okay, or sync, whatever, say, sync value you give, argument. Sync of 0, sync of 1, 2, 3, like that, if you give, okay, value is different. So mean is not constant. Is it clear?
Yes, and the cost of pi, right?
What?
You're finding mean, so it will be the variable into the PDF integrated over the interval, right?
Yes.
So F into cos 2 pi F t, because F is a random variable, you
would
consider F.
No, that's what we did. We considered that only. 1 by F naught was a PDF of F, and cos 2 pi F t is there. So if I integrate this, I'm going to get sine 2 pi F naught t. With respect to F, I'm integrating. So 1 by 2 pi F naught t. 1 by 2 f naught t after substituting the limits f naught.
Okay.
Yeah. The final equation is after substituting the limit f naught. So is this clear? Numerical is fine, but what conclusion you draw from the numericals is more important. Whether the autocorrelation function is becoming independent of time, or the mean is zero, or the mean is depending on the time intervals. Okay, different time intervals, it is different mean you are getting. That thing should be clear. If A is a random variable, in practice, why I'm solving all these numericals is in practice. Okay, are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
So practical example, if I take, okay, do you tell me in 4G LTE, what is the modulation technique used?
I think QPS.
4G in 4G LTE, okay, I call it as bracket 4G LTE, fourth generation, okay, they use different modulation scheme, not only one modulation scheme. They use BPSK, binary phase shift gain. They use QPSK, correct? They use QAM, MQAM. This M could be, they can go till 256 QAM or something like that. So let me write 256. 256 stands for symbols, that's all, nothing else. This is 256 QAM, okay? So they use all these things, all these modulation schemes they use. Depends upon whether you are near to the base station or you are away from the base station. Base station is a mobile network. Suppose you have a base station, okay, and you have a mobile. So this distance, it will be automatically calculated, this distance. So R is the distance between base station, and this is mobile station, okay. So now they will be calculating this distance automatically. Your mobile and base station will be synchronized, they will be communicating with each other. Every time some intervals of 1 millisecond or 5 milliseconds, they'll be communicating and they'll be synced with each other. So base station knows when to use binary phase shift keying modulation, when to use quadrature phase shift keying modulation, when to use 2 QAM. It will be adaptively switching between this modulation scheme without your knowledge. We don't know, but it will be happening. Okay. How it will be happening? If you are near to the base station, what the mobile measures, SNR? SNR will be maximum or minimum if you are near to the base station. Let us assume buildings are less and other.
Maximum.
So that time, you will be getting higher data rate. If you are watching a movie or downloading some video in YouTube, it will be fast because you are near to the base station. Signal to noise ratio of the mobile phone is better. They will be using higher order modulation schemes. 256 QAM, maybe they will use 512 QAM like this. QAM stands for quadrature amplitude modulation. It is a combination of amplitude plus phase. Both are phase of the carrier as well as amplitude of the carrier. Okay. So carrier phase as well as amplitude. So AC and phi C both will be variable. So both are random variables only. When you vary this amplitude of the carrier and phase of the carrier at the receiver, amplitude of the carrier also will be there. Phase of the carrier, both will become random variables. So when we did this numerical, you need to understand, okay, if phase is random, what will happen? How to compute the mean? How to compute the autocorrelation function? How to compute the power of the process? Okay. So this form is quadrature amplitude modulation. This QPSK is phase shift keying technique only. Okay. So this is, hello, are you able to hear me? This is quadrature phase shift keying, PSK. This is binary PSK. So here only phase of the carrier is changed. Here also phase of the
key and PSK.
Phase shift keying. PSK.
Got it.
Phase shift keying. That means you are changing the phase. Like a key, you are turning, right? Key. Phase shift keying. Changing the phase of the carrier. So here again QPSK. Change the face of the carrier, but QAM, quadrature amplitude modulation,
is PAM used, PM, pulse amplitude modulation.
Yeah, pulse amplitude modulation, whenever you have a low distance communication, it is only the amplitude is changed, only amplitude of the carrier is changed there in PAM, only amplitude is changed, frequency and phase is constant. Wherever you have a short distance communication, okay, say If I'm using a local area network in the lab, if you go to in a lab, microprocessor lab, where all the systems are connected to LAN, local area network, right? Where the distance is not so much. So at that time, we can use pulse amplitude modulation, PAM, pulse amplitude modulation. The PAM is not much used, but variation of PAM, they'll be using the variation of PAM, they'll be constructing, using PAM only, they'll construct QAM actually. So you need PAM to construct QAM. If you have to understand QAM correctly, you need to understand PAM, pulse amplitude modulation. Okay? We'll come to all these details when we go ahead. Right now, why I took this example is, base station is adopting to different modulation technique, depends upon the signal to noise ratio is measured at the mobile station. So SNR you have to measure here. If your SNR is poor, then you have to resolve to BPSK, QPSK. So QPSK QAM means you are getting more data rate. BPSK will be getting less data rate, but still you will be getting a service only. You will not be denied service, but you will be getting a service with lower data rate. Have you noticed this? If you sometimes the data rate is very high, you are able to download any video very faster rate. But sometimes it will be buffering. If you observe, if you are listening to some song in YouTube, okay, if you're watching something in YouTube, it will go to buffering stage. You'll be getting a service, but you'll be getting at a lower data rate. So that's why in 4G LTE, something called adaptive modulation techniques. It'll adopt the base station as well as mobile phone. They'll adapt to different modulation schemes. Okay. So that's why it's called adaptive rate modulation. Adaptive modulation schemes are there in 4G LTE. It was not so in 2G, 2.5G and 3G. 4G, it came with adaptive modulation schemes. So this is very, very useful. Okay. So why I took this example, as I told you, here amplitude of the carrier, phase of the carrier, both are changing. At the receiver, when you receive it, both are random variables only. How to deal with this? These are the examples. Yeah. Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir, clear.
Okay. So now let us define one more parameter, auto covariance. Okay. Auto covariance. I'll stop in 2 minutes, exactly at 10 I'll stop, maybe 2-3 minutes. Okay. So auto covariance function we need to determine. So this is given by CXX of T1 comma T2. We'll understand why it is auto covariance is very, very important in practice. Okay. So auto covariance of a continuous time random process of X of T, auto covariance of X of T. X of T is a random process, remember. So we need to find out auto covariance of X of T at time difference. So this is given by covariance of X of T1 and X of T2. Covariance of X of T1, X of T2. So this, by definition, this could be written as CXX of T1 comma T2 is equal to expectation operator of X of T1 minus mean of the T1. And this one, let me put a bracket here one more, into X of T2 minus mu X of T2. So this is, in the random variables also we had this, okay, autocovariance, which is again covariance of same random process at two different intervals of time. So this, let me write, this is mu x is same. So let me write, this is mu x of T1 only. Mu x of T1. Mu x of T1. Now autocovariance function of a random variables also we had similar definition. Now it is only function of time, that's all. Otherwise it was CXS is equal to X or expectation of X minus mu X into X minus mu X, like that. So we didn't have any time index. Okay. So now we have time index. So now this could be written as, so if I want to write this in terms of autocorrelation function, we wrote RXX of T1 comma T2 minus mu X of T1 into mu X of T2. So in terms of autocorrelation and mean, this is actually what autocorrelation is, joint expectation minus individual expectation. Joint expectation is autocorrelation function. Individual expectation means you'll get the mean of the signal. Okay, so this is CXX of T1 comma T2. Okay, so this autocovariance function, where it is helpful is more important than the definition. So autocovariance, this CXX, this function is very helpful when studying a random process which is represented by the sum of a determinist signal plus some random signal like noise. So if we consider this to illustrate this effect, okay, of why, where do we use this autocovariance, okay? So let us consider x of t is equal to s of t plus noise. S of t is a deterministic signal. This is a random signal. So this is a received signal. So I transmitted some deterministic signal. I wanted, okay, it will come to me as it is. But somewhere our friend noise is getting added. Without invitation, it will come. You don't have to invite noise. It will come automatically. So received signal. So now we need to deal with this. Okay. So if I take autocorrelation function T1, T2, how do you write expectation of S of T1 plus N of T1 into S of T2 plus N of T2. Okay. So this is first signal. This is for the second signal. I'm taking the time difference. Okay. So now S of T is a deterministic signal. Only noise is a random signal. You can't take expectation of it for S of T. Now S of T1, S of T2, I'll multiply S of T1, S of T2. S of T1 into N of T2. N of T1, S of T2. So what is S of T1, N of T2? It will be zero, right? What is the mean of the noise? Mean of the noise is zero.
Zero.
Correct? Mean of the noise is zero. So I'll be having four terms. Two terms will cancel. So if I have to write this, so expect S1 of T, S2 of T, I'm writing it as it is because it's a deterministic signal. Expectation of N of T1 into S of T will be zero because mean of the noise is zero. So again, expectation of N of T2 into S1, that is also zero. So I'll be left with only expectation of noise N1, N2, that I'll be writing it as autocorrelation function RNN of T2 minus tau is tau. So this is RxX of T1, T2. Now look at this autocovariance. Now it is more important. What is RxX of tell me.
RxX of T1, T2 can be written as Rx of tau.
Yes.
Only when it's independent of T1 and T2, or I can write it anytime.
If it is depends only on the time difference. If the process depends only on the time difference,
then
not
I
on the time
then I yes. should write it as Rx of tau. Otherwise, it doesn't make
yes. sense. Yes, yes, yes. You're right. Now look at this quickly. 1 minute. Look at this. What is R? If I substitute this equation here, let me call this as equation 1. Equation 2. Tell me now. Equation 2, you substitute in equation 1. What you will get? Substitute equation 2 in terms of equation 1.
CNN of T1, T2 plus
will be equal to what? No. Okay. Substitute this equation 2 in equation 1. Others, quickly. Equation 2 in equation 1, what will you get here? What is this mu x of S1? How did I get this? Hello? Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. So you will get RxX of T1 is equal to S of T1 into S of T2. Plus CNN of T1, T2. That's all.
Okay. So now, So this S1 of T1, S of T2, okay. If I substitute this here, let me use that equation 2. Equation 2 we have got. Now, CX of T1, T2 was VX of T1, T2. So this was, So now use this, if you use the S of T over here, okay, X of T1, X of T2, what will be this equation will be? Mu X of T1, Mu X of T2 means it is S of T1 only, no? Because you're going to get the same answer here.
Correct. Yes, sir.
So correct. It will be S of T1, S of T2. If you use that, S of T1, S of T2, here minus will cancel, right? Then I'll be left with what? CXS of T1, T2 will be equal to RNN of T1, T2. That means this covariance, auto covariance function, whatever we had, okay? So it is helping us to differentiate the noise process and the signal process. Signal is determined signal. We're able to differentiate the noise as well as signal if I take the auto covariance function. Okay. Anyway, we'll discuss more about this in the next class. We'll take a break. Okay. Thank you. We'll stop here.
Sir, what's RNN? You said auto correlation between noise signals is zero.
No. RNN is not zero. S1 of T, S2 of T, if I substitute this here, these two with this will cancel. So I'll be getting covariance function between T1, T2 will be equal to RNN of T1, T2. This is covariance is going to help us to separate the noise process and deal. Once we separate the noise process from the signal, we can find out what is the signal mean, signal variance directly.
So RNN is like autocorrelation between
the noise samples.
Okay.
Fine. Okay. We'll stop here.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
So could you, the third and fourth notes, if you share only second.
What?
So could you share the third and the fourth notes?
I'm trying to share, but there was some problem yesterday in Google Meet, Google Classroom. It was not posting. I was able to upload, but I could not post it. It's some error it was showing. So I'll resolve it today. Today we'll do it. No problem.
Okay. Thank you.
Rahul has started working and programming different codes. At least 2-3 programs you have to try it daily. Then only you people can get the some hold on this particular course. Sai Kailesh?
Yes, ma'am, solving.
Okay. Krishna Prasad? Krishna Prasad? Krishna Prasad? Hello, Krishna Prasad? I think if you don't respond by maybe one call, you will be put absent or something. Okay, Nayana? Nayana?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Tanmay? 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 Tanmay, are you present? Yes, Tanmay. Maybe this is the way your attendance also is getting marked, because it's getting recorded and your attendance also is getting marked. So if you don't respond to that one, it will be put absent. So I cannot help it afterwards. Sri Nikhil?
Yes, ma'am.
So have gone through yesterday whatever we have done?
I mean, not entirely.
Can you just tell what we have done yesterday? Can you just brief me yesterday whatever we have done it? Any one of you, whoever has attended yesterday, and can you just brief what we have done yesterday? And otherwise, no point in going into that much depth. Just I can do some programming and I can leave it.
Ma'am, I had a doubt, ma'am. Is a maximum loss function is it negative of the cross entropy function, like maximum likelihood function in this?
Maximum likelihood, I will come to that one. I will, when I come to, because when I am explaining maximum likelihood estimation itself, I will teach once again.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, because when you take the likelihood function, it is without the negative.
Yes, without ma'am. So you will get is negative of that.
Correct.
Okay, ma'am.
So can you just explain, any one of you, because what we have done yesterday? I want to understand how much you understood yesterday's class.
Ma'am, we solved weight updation algorithm. Like, we have seen the procedure how to solve the weight updation algorithm. We have three different procedures. We have this gradient search and stochastic and other one.
Maximum likelihood estimation.
So those, and also for the linear and logistic regression, both we have two search algorithms, gradient search and stochastic search. So we were seeing yesterday how to solve the gradient descent algorithm, minimizing the mean square error, using the slope and how to find the weights. So this was done yesterday.
Okay. So because why I'm just trying to do it in depth of this particular one is this is the concept where it is used for both machine learning and deep learning, more or less the algorithms of that one. And also here the concepts, whatever I told, at least go through 2-3 times so that each and every point, whatever we discussed is very important. May not be, you just don't look at the exam point of view. I'm not talking about the exam point of view. Always exam point of view, it will be very, not that much to worry about that one. But concept point of view, and when you are writing a algorithm, good algorithm, better algorithm, the compared to your other ML engineers, and also to develop a model which is best suitable for a particular application. So for all those things, the concepts behind this particular one is very important. How to choose the parameters? How to choose the parameters? That is the one which we are really looking into that one. Maybe this concepts wise, look at, go through that video, whatever we have done, at least 2-3 times and note down the points in some place, because those are the points, critical points, some things we discussed yesterday. So let me recap that whatever we have done it, and let us go for the next topic of the. So before going to yesterday, we were looking at in any, whether it is a linear regression algorithm or a logistic regression algorithm, we are trying to find out the best fit line of the, or we are trying to find out some kind of optimized solution for that one or optimized model design. So when you want to do this particular one, let us look at linear regression point of view. So in case of linear regression point of view, so we are trying to find out what is the, from the given way, from initial weights, and x1 and x2 are the different features of this one. We are trying to find out what is y cap. After, from the y cap, we are finding out the desired, the difference between the desired input and the predicted input, a predicted output, desired output and the predicted output, a summation over all the samples of this one. And from this error, we're finding out the error square or minimum mean square, a mean square error, or this mean square error can be represented by as a cost function in case of linear regression model, or it's, it can be represented by xi or mean square error. So it is given by the formula, that is sum of squares of the difference between the actual output and the predicted output. Now for this one, to minimize this particular error, so there is a parameter here, this predicted error has to be approximately,
when your screen is not visible.
Okay. I shared it. Oh, sorry. No? Now is it visible?
Not yet, ma'am.
Not yet. How come?
Yeah, it will be coming, madam.
Sorry, sir. Yeah. Now?
Yeah, madam, it has
now
come.
Is it coming?
Yes, madam.
Okay. Okay. So now in this particular one, yesterday's slightly we'll look at whatever the yesterday we have done it, and we'll go for what is the disadvantage of yesterday's method and how to overcome that one. That's what today's class we are going to do. So in that one, any linear regression is a predicting model or estimating a model, whatever it is, when you take it. So that particular model, in that one, we are trying to find out predicted output, that is y cap, using this linear algebraic equation. So we can represent by a linear algebraic equation, that is y w naught plus w1 x1 plus w2 x2, or we can write in a vector form, that is w transpose x. Okay, any form we can. So from this one, we are going to find out the mean square error. That's one also we know. And this, the objective of this whole of the function is how to reduce the mean square error. So to reduce this mean square error, we understood that one, y, a desired output y has to be similar to, approximately same as a predicted output. So how we can make the predicted output approximated to this one? So for that one, in our hand, what is there is the weights. That is W0, W1, W2. So by varying weights or by adjusting weights or by updating the weights, so that this particular one is approximately equal. So here in this one, using this weight updations algorithm, that is in the bracket, whatever in the feedback loop, whatever it is there, using this weight updation algorithm, we update the weights in such a way that this error is minimized. So this is the whole process we are going to do it. So in that particular one, in case of a simple linear regression, we discussed there are three methods in that one. One is a simple normal solution or a closed form solution, which is nothing but using the formula. But here it takes more time, and also sometimes it's difficult to converge it, and the computation time also is more. So practically that is not a feasible solution. So the second approach is based on the gradient estimation. So based on the gradient estimation method, the second method, it is a whether gradient search algorithm or modifications of a gradient search algorithm. So using these algorithms, it is possible to update the weights. Third method afterwards we look at, that is maximum likelihood estimation method. That one we are not trying to. Now let us see what is this gradient search algorithm. So this gradient search algorithm, yesterday when we looked at this one, when you vary weight of the any of these weights, so with respect to weights, the error function is like a kind of a convex function. So when it is a convex function, there is a some kind of global minima. This global minima gives you a minimum error. That minimum error is represented by minimum mean square error. So with respect to one weight, if you draw, this is the representation. With respect to two weights, if you draw, that this kind of bowl shape of the representation. So that, so in this bowl shape of the representation also, this is the minimum error we are going to find out. So how we are going to find out? Look at it. So in the algorithm, that particular one, with respect to one weight, single weight, when you look at, so whether it's a bowl shape, where is the function is f of x. How to find out if f of x is a function, how to minimize the function? So f dash of x, differentiate it with respect to x and equate it to zero. That's what we are doing. Same thing. So here we are differentiating it, and equating to zero means you move towards the minimum value of that one. So here in this particular case also, x-axis is weight, y-axis is a mean square error, and when you plot this particular kind of this one, so from this, using a gradient approximation or gradient method, we are going to update the weights. So let us see. So here in this one, you have selected initially W0, some random weight. So from that random weight, you are going to update the new weight. How you are going to update the new weight? So new weight is equal to old weight, that is W0, minus the gradient, the slope at that particular W0. So the slope value may be whatever may be, but we want to restrict, we want to have control on that slope. So how to give control on slope? That's why a controlling parameter or a hyper parameter is used. That hyper parameter or the controlling parameter for that particular gradient is a learning weight. So here, then if you see the algorithm, new weight is equal to, and that means the next weight is equal to old weight minus some controlling parameter multiplied by the gradient at that particular point. So this controlling parameter can be, there are various names for that particular. You can call it as a learning rate or convergence parameter or step size. There is one more name, that is a step size of that one. So using this particular one, you can just wherever is the initial weight, we are trying to move to the minimum of the surface. So when you are trying to move minimum of the surface, whenever there is a minimum kind of this one, so that you can stop the criteria, you can stop at this particular point, and that particular point corresponds to the minimum weight, like this minimum error, and the corresponding weight, whatever it is there, that is the optimum weight. So when you are doing this particular one here, there are two things which we are looking at. One is, suppose if the learning rate is too large, what happens? When it is too small, what happens? If it is too small, if a value is 0.001, 0.01 like that, if it is too small, it takes some small steps, variations in small steps, a move in small steps into the negative of the curve. And in this particular one, when you are this moving to the negative of this one, it takes more number of iterations. The iterations is from 1 to 2 is one iteration, 2 to 3 is another iteration, 3 to 4 is another. That means each updation, weight updation is called a iteration. That is in the previous one, whatever we have seen. So completing this one cycle is one iteration. So by completing one cycle, you are able to get one iteration. So from here to get it, it takes more number of iterations when the convergence rate is small. But the advantage in this particular one is because you are taking small steps of that one. So converging at this particular point, the error at this particular point is less compared to when learning rate is large. So this is one thing which we have to understand. When eta is large, it takes larger steps. So when it takes larger steps based on that one, sometimes it may converge very fast. When it converges very fast here, when you look at it converges fast, we don't know whether to take this one as a minimum error or this one as a minimum error. If you take this one as a minimum error, so the actual error is here, but this is a predicted error. So there may be a lot of difference in this one. So when eta is large, that is the step size is large, it takes only within 2-3 iterations, you may come down to the minimum value. But at the minimum value, there may be more error between the actual value to the predicted whatever the value obtained from this one. So when we are doing this particular one, there is a trade-off in that particular. How many iterations? Iterations are, you call it as epochs. So either iterations are epochs. It is not epochs. Epochs. So here when learning rate is very small, takes more number of iterations, but accuracy is good. When you take this particular one, is the other principle. Now, how you are going to calculate? Yesterday, one of them asked how you are going to calculate the gradient at that particular point. So, when you take the equation here, I have taken only one feature, one independent variable. So, when you take one independent variable in that one, so the equation, the predicted equation, model equation is given by W0 plus W1x. Where W0 is the bias and W1 is the weight equation, and from this one you're getting the J, that is mean square equation. So when you differentiate with respect to D by DW0 and D by DW1. So this particular one can be represented by a partial differential partial equation, that is DZ by DY cap, DY cap by DW0. So DZ by DY cap is this one, that is 2 times of y minus y cap, and dy cap by dw0, dy cap by dw0 is this one. This is the one something kind we use it in back propagation also. So using this particular method, you can find out, you can differentiate with respect to w0 and you can differentiate with respect to w1. So using this one, this by differentiating, you are getting the differentiated value. So from that particular one, you can calculate what is the new W0 and new W1. So new W0 is equal to old W0 minus eta times of d xi by dw0. So this is the equation. Whereas for any other weights, new weight of W1, W2, W3, when you are finding out, W1 new is equal to W0 old minus this particular equation. So while doing this, all these things, we understood two things. One is, what is the relationship? What is the xi equation? What is the xi equation? So you have got the xi equation as in the beginning of the expressions we have seen, E of dk square plus w transpose rw minus w transpose p transpose w, some kind of equation. So when you take any performance equation, is in the form of a quadratic equation. And also when it is a quadratic expression of this one, when you plot between any of the between any two weights, so it comes in this particular way, that is some kind of ellipse if the weights are not of a different scale. if weights are on the same scale as a circle. So if in machine learning, if weights are on the same scale, features are on the same scale, then you can take that particular one as, or the time taken to converge is less compared to this particular one. So here in the data pre-processing in machine learning, the first step what you are going to do is using some standard scalar, you are using some min-max optimization, min-max finding out the maximum value and minimum value of that one. You can scale it to, so here you see, you find out the maximum value and minimum value and find out, rescale the data set between 0 to 1. This way you can write a function, or you can use a standard scalar function to bring all the features onto the same scale between 0 to 1 scale of that one. So this is one thing we yesterday we looked at, those. But the here there are three to four things what we have to observe. See this program afterwards I will show you, because I have written small program. Now when you look at this one, what is the points we have to take it up? The points what we have to take at this for a gradient descent algorithm is, first thing is, when you are doing a weight updation algorithm, all the samples are taken at a time. All the samples means, now x is the input, y is the output, and all the samples are 1, 2, 10 are the instances. We can call it as an instance, or we can call it as by example, or we can call by some data set, whatever it is. So here, each of this particular one, whatever the rows corresponding to this particular one, you can call by instance, or you can call by example, or you can call this particular one by some data point. So here in this case, in case of the gradient descent algorithm, all these points, suppose if there are 1,000 data sets or 1,000 samples, so or samples, whatever it is, samples. So 1,000 samples if you have, all the 1,000 samples are taken at a time, and we are using this particular one for weight updation. So here in gradient descent algorithm, all the samples are considered, first point is, all the samples are considered for weight updation. This is a very important point. So when you consider all the 1,000 points, what is the disadvantage? It takes more time. That's the reason in the new weight is equal to old weight minus eta of, when you take that particular one, d xi by dw of this one when you take it. So here you are going to take as a sigma of y minus y cap whole square, where I is equal to 1 to n. So we are taking all the samples at a time. This is the first one. So by taking, because when you are taking all the samples at a time, the disadvantage of this one is it takes more time, or the complexity also is increased. Because when you want to perform all these things, maybe the memory size, whatever is required, or whatever the computation time is required, and all those things, it increases. So it is, the complexity is increased, and also it requires more time to compute this one. Third point, here in this case of optimal gradient descent method, it is an offline method. It is an offline method, because whole set of data points we are considering it, whole data points we are considering, then we are doing the entire set of this one. Because we are considering whole of these data points and considering it, so that this particular one is a deterministic in nature. So because it is a deterministic in nature, when you look at this one, from here, from the initial value to this value, directly it goes without any zigzag of that one. Or from the iteration to error, when you take it, iteration to error, this is the iteration con. Iteration to error when you take it. So So properly it will come down to this way. So here this is a deterministic nature of this one. So because we are taking all the samples at a time, this kind of this one is called a batch gradient descent algorithm also. Batch gradient descent algorithm. Because completely batch of samples, all full training set is taken to update the weights. So full training set is taken. Full training set is taken to update the weights. And but one more disadvantage. What is the other disadvantage of this one? We have seen this particular one. We are not able to escape from a local minimum. So it cannot escape from a local minimum. Already we have seen. Especially when lambda is minimum, eta is minimum, when eta is small. So according to that stop criteria, we are not able to escape from the local minima. So because of these disadvantage of this particular one, but one advantage of this one is it is able to optimize to the minimum error, or optimize to the, or it's going to give optimal solution. Because the meaning of optimal solution means in this particular one it is able to find out xi minima for that particular weight value. Because one is you're taking a full set of the samples, other one is you're taking small kind of learning rate of this one, small step size. So with this particular baby steps of this one, it is able to land to the minima of this one. So it is possible to find out the optimal solution with that. Whereas the disadvantage is that it cannot escape from the local minimum. Second one is it is taking the full training set of samples. So if the complexity of this particular whole of the implementation, it is taking more time and more resources. So to overcome this particular disadvantage, we've gone for a new algorithm. That is a stochastic gradient descent algorithm. So here, to overcome this particular one, stochastic gradient descent. So here, when it is stochastic gradient descent, it overcomes two, three problems. Let me tell you, then I will explain what it is. First thing is, here in gradient descent is offline data. So it is with the offline data. So some kind of real-time applications, if you want to do it, especially if not machine learning, if something else, a real-time application where the input signal, whatever I'm talking, you know, it is coming, it has to update the weights and all those things. So in case of real-time applications, if you want to do it, so at that particular sample, we have to find out what is the new update. So in case of online method, this particular method, this case of stochastic gradient descent helps a lot. Because this stochastic gradient descent, it doesn't depend on the entire data set. It depends on only at that particular instance. So with this one, we will start the next discussion. Now can I just find out whether you have any doubts in this one?
Ma'am, in this gradient descent algorithm, we have like you told that we need to check all the samples, no, ma'am?
Yes,
but
yes.
If we check all the samples, we need only the one minimum square error value, no, ma'am, at that point. So what is the use of checking all the samples?
Oh, you got in a different term. Okay. Anybody else? Anyone? Any other doubts? So that I can clarify.
About this offline data points and online data points, can you repeat it again?
Okay. Anything else? Anything else? Okay. So these two points, let me once again clarify it, then we'll go for the actual. So your other friend is asking, I think the whole of this particular one, you are looking only at one particular as a one single weight. It is not one single weight. So here when I talk about this particular one, so I will take some other one because not required. So when I take this any kind of, when I just make, I have given one weight. It is not with respect to one weight. To make you understand, I have taken one weight. If you take two weights, something different. If you take three weights, I don't know how to draw also. Okay. But when I am talking about this particular one, you have to understand that it is not with respect to one weight or two weights. It is with respect to the, suppose if you have 10 data points, 10 features, x1 to x7, 7 features and one output, then you will get w1 to w7. With respect to w1 to w7. This w1 to w7, how I am representing? It is w1 to w7. Maybe some bias also if you add w0. So this whole thing I am talking as a vector, not as a point. So when I tell this particular one, when it is optimized, that means all these weights are optimized. All these weights are optimized. So when I tell this particular weight vectors, the weight vectors are optimized. Each weight is optimized in such a way that means two weights, if you take it, two weights are optimized so that the corresponding point you will get the output of this. So in marathon, one person if performs, it's not too good. If each and every athletic has to perform well, so that then only the marathon whoever is, that group will win. The same way, in that particular case, this whole set of this one has to be optimized. So to optimize this one, here in this case of this, we are taking the entire data set. Entire data set means, so here one, x1 to x, 1 to 100. So it is 1 to 100 samples. So when you take 1 to 100 samples, as I just mentioned in this one, this whole set of data samples, the whole set of data samples means you take this particular one as I is equal to 1 to 10 data samples, and here it is y minus yi cap whole square. So here I am taking this entire data set, each data set value of this one I am considering it. So when I consider each data set point of this one, then only I can get the whatever the values. So when I optimize this one, so I am going to get corresponding to x1, what is w1? Corresponds to x2, what is the w2? Corresponds to x7, what is w7? So that the entire depth, the whatever the y cap is there, this is approximately equal to. Is it the first doubt? Is it, or shall I show you the program?
Yes, ma'am.
Look at this program. Are you able to see?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So in this program, a simple program of that one, we have taken eta is learning rate, number of iterations as 100, and number of samples have taken it as 100. And some x random values it's generated. The random function generates its 100 samples of one column of that one, and from that particular one to make x underscore b is to get this kind of data. That is, wait. So x underscore b is equal to, here I am not able to write it. So when I take x underscore b is equal to this particular one. So x is a random set, random 100 samples. X underscore b is, because here you need a bias also. So the first element is 1 and rest of the elements are whatever the elements are there, this one. So x here in this program, x underscore b is, that is the one it is coming. That is as a two column vectors. First column is 1 and second column is whatever the random. And y is equal to some equation I have taken, and that particular one random noise is added so that you will get the samples. And that particular samples when you plot it, so the way you are going to get the samples are, these are the blue dots represents the representation between x and y. And I plotted the x and y of that. Then after plotting that one, random values of w is taken, that is initialization. So here we have w naught and w1 is required. That's why it is a two rows and one column. So some random values it is considered. Then now we are, I'm doing some gradient method. So what is the gradient method? Some iterations. So here iterations in this particular case, iterations is 100 iterations I've considered. So 100 iterations. And gradient, it's calculated gradient, that is d xi by that particular one. Already we know that it is x transpose into x into dot product of w, x transpose w minus y. X transpose w is y cap minus w. So here when you differentiate it, already we have seen when you differentiate e into xi it comes. Similarly here also, this is e part, this is y cap and this one. So the updated weight is w is equal to old weight, is u weight is equal to old weight minus eta here 0.1 into gradient. And that particular one I plotted. So here when I plot this one, because this is not required, I will remove this one. Here also it's not required. I'll remove this one. I'll run it. So when you run this particular one, you could see exactly it is fitting. Now I will change the value. Now instead of this particular one, instead of 100 iterations, I will take only 10 iterations or 12, 10 iterations. So let me run once again. Iterate of this one. So here, let me remove this one because something else I think I have put it. So now you see here 0.99 when I put it and 10 iterations, you are not able to find out where is the line. Now let me reduce this particular one to 0.1, 0.091. So let me run. So when I run this one, it is able to get it. And let me reduce the this particular one, let me take it to 0.05 and increase the iterations. So you can make out what is happening in this one. So here this best fit line or fit line depends on, now here the, instead of finding out using W0, W1, using that particular equation, by varying this eta and the number of iterations, we are trying to find out. So here, the, how many samples have taken? You see here in this particular one, I'm multiplying or dividing this particular one for complete range of all the samples. So 100 samples, whatever is there for all the entire samples of this one, I'm running. So this simple program, you just run it. So that for various etas and iterations and various samples, how this line is behaving, you can make out. That is one kind of a program you can just try. So to understand that. Next. Now here when I'm taking this case of, in this case, the whole of the data is already available. So with the available data, I'm trying to find out the gradient and the updated weights. So with the available data, when whole available data, when I'm trying to do it, that particular process is offline gradient estimation method. So here, whatever the gradient estimation method, what you are doing in this case is an offline gradient estimation method. Whether I answered both the questions?
Yes, ma'am. Mine is correct.
Okay. Shall I go ahead next one?
Ma'am, I had doubt. In the Python program, you wrote y predict as x into w, like x dot w. You didn't consider the bias term. Why, ma'am?
Where? In that particular one, bias term is coming. In that one, bias term is there.
In X,
It's there. Because in that particular program, what I have done is what I have taken is, it is W itself is a vector. See this one. W itself is a vector. When it is a vector, that means W not W1. Let me put, that's why you see there are two things it's coming. First one is W0, second one is W1.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So yes, here, that is the one you don't look at as a one single variable. You always look this one as a vectors and matrix. Then things will become all right. Is it clear? Shall I go for the next one? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, others, shall I go for the next one? I just put it in the chat box. Have understood gradient descent? And what is the advantage and disadvantage, and what are the points on that particular one? Okay. Now we have understood that there are some disadvantages, and this is not the practical solution for many machine learning algorithms. First thing is, when you are taking machine learning algorithm, the requirement is you have a large data set in that particular one, and as a large number of instances or examples or data for samples or whatever it is, all the words are same. So in that particular one, as we have large number of data, large data set is available, so this is not the feasible solution. So here, just for understanding, we have used it, but it is not the solution. What is it? But the same concept is used for the further analysis. So other name for this one, you just keep in. So this is the batch gradient descent. Batch gradient descent means full training set is used. Next one. So the next one is a stochastic gradient descent model. So what is this stochastic gradient descent method? So in this stochastic gradient descent method, so already the same example of x, y of this. So here 1 to 10 samples of this one. So when you take 1 to 10 samples of this one, so here, as I just mentioned, you can call it as 1 to 10 samples. Why I'm giving the different words are this one, 1 to 10 samples or data points, are instances or examples, because in different books different notations are used. That is the reason, because Tom Mitchell, one notation it is used in deep learning by Goodfellow, the other notation is used Eppleman, one other notation is used. So different examples are different, but whatever it is, so now we look at this particular one, a different instance. So here, in case of stochastic gradient, this optimization algorithm, whatever you call the stochastic gradient descent optimization algorithm, it is based on single instance at a time. So it is, this one is based on single instance at a time. Single instance or single example or single data point at a time. That means, so here in this one, when you look at y cap of this one, so here the y, so here when you look at y cap is equal to w naught plus w1. Now for the first one, we'll find out what is y cap, what are the estimated w naught and w1, and for the second one, once again we'll find out what is w naught for this one and w1. So for each of this particular one, we'll find out what is the updated weight. And after completing this updated weight, once again, this whole completion is takes one iteration. So one from 1 to 10 or 1 to 1000 or whatever it is, the each one takes one iteration. So this particular each iteration time, we're trying to find out what is the updated weight. After completing one updated weight, or after completing in one iteration that one, then go for the second iteration. So in this second iteration, once again update the weights. So in this particular case of this, so when you look at this, the only difference when it comes to the equation point is, so the updated weights is equal to, we can write updated weights as wk plus 1 is equal to wk minus d by dw of yi minus yi cap whole square. So here, this particular instant of time, or I can take it as, so this one, it gives you the sample size, first sample where I is equal to 1 to 100 of this one. So here there is no summation here. There is no summation. So here when you take this particular one, each weight is updated based on the instant at that particular point. So here when you look at this one, the same W1 mu is equal to, we will solve one problem on this one also so that you will understand. So W1 volt minus the same whatever we discussed, 2 eta ei into xi, yesterday whatever we got it. And also same thing, W nu is equal to W naught volt minus 2 eta into ei. So the equations are same. Only the difference in this particular one is here at each instant of this one, whenever there is an input coming into picture, xi, at that particular instant, we are going to find out the output, update the weights of this one. That is in case of time domain signal. If it is a machine learning signal, at each instant of time or each example, we are trying to find out what is the updations of this one. So here in this one, when you look at, when you try to write the program for this one, so here the program when you write it, so here I is equal to 1 to maybe this, it gives you iterations, maybe 10 iterations, and for I is equal to, or k is equal to 1 to 5, maybe that 1 to 5 is a number of samples, or rows. In our case, it is rows. That is here in this case, whatever, or number of instances, whatever it is. And then we are going to find out for each of the weight. So if there are, in this case, if the features are, some 10 features are there, we have to find out 10 weights. So the next one is for weights is equal to n is equal to 1, 2, or maybe 3. That is, this represents weights. Then here you update the weight. So in case of gradient descent, previously what we talked, only the iterations and updating the weights, only two loops we could see. Whereas here in this particular case, for each sample also you are doing it in updation of this one. So here by doing this way, there are some advantages of it. What are the advantages? Let us see. So when you take what is the whole of this one, because you are doing each sample at a time, that is the first sample. So for the first one, you are finding out the, what is the update from the initial weight, the new weight, and from the second one, we are going to find out, and the third one, and that. So by doing this particular way, if any local minima is there, you can escape local minima. Because you are considering different instances, at each instant you are finding out. So it is possible to find out a local minimum. And also here in this particular one, here the one more point what we have to observe in this case is, because it is depending on, for each iteration, if you are finding out the mean square error, and it depends on xi at instant of time. So because it is depending on xi is a random variable. So here whatever they are getting, the weights also are random, or error also random. So here whatever you are getting in this particular one is a very important criteria. So here this particular error is also stochastic in nature, or random in nature. It is not deterministic as the previous one. Okay. So because of this particular random in nature, what is the disadvantage of this one? So when you look at the disadvantage of this one is, when you look at this performance surface, when from here to come to this one, it will come in a zigzag, this particular one, and it lands at this particular point. So there is some uncertainty at this particular point of this one. So the error in this case, actual Zeimin to predicted Zeimin or calculated from stochastic Zeimin will be different. So here we can tell this particular one, it's a good solution, but not the optimal solution. But not optimal solution. Because here when it comes to the bottom of the bowl, it is some kind of stochastic in nature. Stochastic means it will be moving here and there of that particular one. So because of this one, this is not giving a optimal solution. Or in other way, when you took a, take between W1 to W2, which is a concentric circles of this cave, kind of this one. So when from here to move to the next one, to move to the next one, in case of gradient descent, directly it goes. Whereas here it takes kind of zigzag path of this. So this zigzag path is because of this xi. Because it depends on directly on the xi. With xi is random in nature. So because xi is random in nature, w also is random in nature. And because of this one, the path in this one also is a stochastic path in nature. So because of these three reasons of this particular one, though it is a good solution, but it is not optimal a solution when it comes. But what is the advantage of this particular one? Because here you are taking each sample and each instance of time. So here because it is, maybe within 2-3 iterations itself, it may come to the optimal solution. Because you found out what is W0 and W1. From this one, you would have taken as a next weight of this particular one for the next one and the next one. So here, because each instant at a time when you are taking it, it takes less number of iterations to reach to the, so less number of iterations to reach optimal solution. Because you are taking one sample at a time. Whereas in case of gradient descent, you are taking batch of samples. That means all set of samples, complete set of samples. So that therefore the computation time is more or more number of iterations is required. Whereas here you are taking one sample at a time. From the first sample, you can take that one as the initial input, initial weights to the next one, and you can proceed it. So in that way, you will get optimal solution with less number of iterations. So this one, because it's take less number of computations, definitely we can tell the complexity is less compared to the previous one. Complexity is less compared to the previous one. But here in this, some more things in this one is there. And also, as I just mentioned, because of this this kind of eta value, convergence value, it is possible to escape local minima. Let us see how it is possible to escape the local minima. So to escape local minima, the condition is, or the one is, this is a local, to escape local minima, suppose if you take larger value of convergence parameter, it is possible to take local minima, possible to escape local minima. That means from here, suppose if you take a larger value, it may come down to here. If you take a larger value, it may come down to here. But what happens if a larger value of local convergence parameter, if you take, it may not go for the optimum value. So what is the solution for this particular one? So in this case of stochastic gradient descent method, there is something called learning schedule. So using learning schedule, using learning schedule, it is possible to escape local minima. So what is this learning schedule? That is, learning schedule is nothing but, now when you are doing this first iteration, for the first iteration I may take as one eta 1. When you am going for the second iteration, I may reduce eta 1 by 10. When I am going for the third iteration, I may reduce the eta 1 by 100. Or some value. That means for each iteration, the convergence parameter can be reduced. So this is the one kind of a very important point it is possible in case of a stochastic gradient descent. So here, because of this particular one, it is possible to escape local minima. As I just mentioned, assume that start with a large value of local, large value of eta, learning rate. Then first iteration is completed. First iteration completed. Then reduce eta value. Because when you first iterate, after first iteration, any local minima are there, it can be escaped. local minima can be escaped. Now reduce eta value by some value, reduce eta value by some parameter. Then you go for the second iteration. So this way, by repeating this particular process, it is possible to escape local minima, and also it is possible to, by reducing eta value, we understood one more point. It is possible to, for a low eta value, we understood that particular one, it is possible to get more accuracy result, accurate result. That is, the estimated xi min can be approximated to the whatever the required value. Our error is, error between xi min to the actual predicted value will be less in that particular case. Or it is possible to get better optimized solution. Better optimized solution. So here, to get low eta value, using learning schedules, it is possible to reduce. And this whole process of this particular one, changing eta at every iteration, is nothing but simulated annealing. So reducing eta learning rate at every iteration is simulated annealing. So you can look at this particular process also when it is in case of a stochastic gradient descent. So in most of the in Python there is a function SGD regressor. So go through sklearn and see what is this SGD regressor, and in that one, what is that function parameters. In this function parameters, you can see what is the learning rate, how many epochs, what is the batch size, what is the other things. You can go to the next the discussion. Let me try to understand how much you understood. Any doubts in this one, or you want me to explain?
Three times we are solving, ma'am, like number of iterations once, and then number of samples, and then weights also.
Yes.
In that three, we should keep the eta value constant, no, ma'am, to get the correct one.
So here what happens is, in this algorithm, what I will do is, after each iteration, so here maybe eta is equal to maybe some value if you take it x. So here at each iteration, I may reduce this eta by some parameter, delta parameter.
So after it is like we need to go on reducing the eta value.
Yes. Suppose if you feel there are more local minima.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So all these things, it is, there is no standard one. Okay. For this set of this one, I have to do this one. No, it's nothing is there. It is how best you are going to optimize. That's why though some set of algorithms are available, how you are going to do it. Okay. That is, it's left to those who have understood the subject, the way they may do it may be different. Those who have whatever the existing programs, if they run, it may be different. So if you understand, oh, there are so many local minimas are there, when you plot the graph and all those things, so many local, is it possible to do this one?
Okay. Based on the graph, we can decide the eta values, whether to keep decreasing or choose the correct value.
Correct. That way you can decrease it, or you can look at the data set, how it is, and then according to that also you can do it.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Any other doubts in this case? Because these concepts, something it's really interesting and required. Anything else?
Ma'am, when sample number is increasing, the output will also take more time.
Sample number is increasing. Okay, that is the reason. The next one is, now you got the point. Here the point is, as you are mentioning, there are 10,000 samples. Each one, if I have to do it, it is very difficult.
Yes.
Okay, and it is waste of time also. That's why there is a, practically now what is going on is not even this one. There is a mini batch stochastic gradient descent algorithm. Shall I go for the next one, or any doubts in this one?
Ma'am, then actually it takes more time than batch gradient descent, ma'am, when compared.
But here in this case, the number of iterations what it is taking is less.
Okay. When the sample number is less, it takes less time than batch to gradient descent.
No, if sample size more also, what happens there, it is 1,000 samples at a time it has to do. So computationally more resources are required. Computationally more resources are required. With that one set, it is not possible. Here what is happening is because of this process, maybe it is taking less number of iterations. Maybe to whole set to complete, it may be taking maybe 2-3 iterations may be sufficient. There it may be required, 10 iterations may be required. So one is the time is more in that case. Second one is computational complexity means number of operations what it is going to perform on hardware is more. Any other doubts? Shall I go for the next one? Or 2 minutes can you just give me?
Ma'am, in this stochastic gradient descent, the number of iterations equals the number of data points, no ma'am?
No. Number of iterations is equal from 1 to 10, once if it performs, it is one iteration.
Then the second iteration, how will it?
Second iteration, so the previous weights, whatever updated, that one will be taken as the initial weights.
Okay, like then that, how many times we can do, ma'am?
That one, till you get the optimized value. Till you get the optimized value is till you get to the minimum value.
Okay.
So, in real, in ML algorithm, when you are doing it, the procedure generally you will follow in that particular one. One is, where you write for I is equal to, one to maybe a very large high value of this one you take iterations, number of iterations, but that many you may not, it may not be required. So here this stopping criteria, whatever it is, you can take the stopping criteria whenever the mean square error, gradient of the mean square error is almost constant, or whenever the mean square error is greater than the, our weights are not much changing. So here weight updations when you are doing, from the weight updations, so the this first one weight, second, so W1, W2, W3, so these are the weights changing for each. So this is first iteration, this is the first iteration, second iteration, third iteration. So each of this one, when weights are not much changing in this particular one, then we can stop that particular one. So though you give higher, so many iteration values, we need not perform all the iterations. You can see whether weights are changing much or not. Or you can see with respect to K, with respect to iteration value, whether performance in this particular one, whether it is remains constant in it. Suppose if it is like this, if it is remain, here we need not go up to 10,000. We can stop at this particular, maybe 200 itself. Okay. So the stopping criteria is, as I just mentioned, you can look at this particular one graph, or you can look at the weights whether there is any updation, or you can keep a count on this particular iterations also. So any one of this particular one can be the stopping criteria.
Ma'am?
Okay.
Is there any rule that the number of iterations should be greater than the number of features in stochastic, because we are taking one feature at a time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So should the number of iterations be more than that to include all of them?
There is no such rule in that particular one. There is no such rule.
There's a few parameters, right, ma'am? Like if we don't consider the number of iterations to be greater than the number of examples or features, we'll miss out them.
Okay. Number of instances. Okay. Number of samples of this particular one. Okay. So what happens is when you are doing this whole process of this, actually, when I just mentioned in this, we are going to take some kind of, this is not the practical approach. This is not the practical. In this one, we are going to take a mini batch of stochastic gradient descent algorithm. What you mentioned is a drawback, because in case of stochastic gradient descent method, as you mentioned, definitely we have to take number of iterations greater than number of samples according to this one. So this is one kind of disadvantage of that one, because as I just mentioned, one side there is no restriction on that one, but other side the restriction, as you mentioned in this particular one, the number of samples are not considered. So if I have 10,000 samples, whether I have to do 10,000 kinds of this particular one. So one thing what it is iteration is different, number of samples are different. Try to understand. Iteration, in this iteration is the whole thing performing once is a iteration. One iteration means from 1 to 10,000 performing one operation once is one iteration. One updates is one iteration. Who has asked? Once again? Okay. 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 Once again. So here the iteration, the meaning of iteration is one set of weight updations finished from 1 to 10. That is one iteration. Second iteration, 1 to 10, once again, second time you are performing. That is the second iteration. So iteration is different from number of samples. So always iterations can be less than number of samples.
But here we are considering one sample at a time. So that is one.
Okay, correct. It's not one iteration. So that goes with the second loop. Second loop.
Okay.
Yes. First loop is the iteration. That's why I've written as a code. First loop is the iteration. Second loop is number of samples. Third loop is number of features. Third loop is number of features. Second loop is it is number of samples. So there is no such this particular one. Number of iterations has to be greater than number of samples. But this, as you mentioned, whether we have to take all the, is it possible to reduce the second one is the question. Is it possible to reduce this second row? Now, if it is, there are 1,000 samples are there, whether I have to do all the 1,000 samples, that is the one which we are going to look at that one in mini batch gradient descent method. So tomorrow's class, we will see mini batch gradient descent algorithm and also one or two problems on this stochastic gradient descent algorithm. So before concluding this one, let me give you a brief overview of this. So now we have seen gradient descent method. It is a deterministic method. It is a deterministic method and it takes more computations, more complexity because all samples at a time it takes. That is a one point you have to carry forward. In case of gradient descent, all samples, 1,000 samples are there. When you are calculating weight updation, it is doing with all 1,000 at a time. And that one is called batch gradient descent algorithm and it is a deterministic algorithm. It is an offline algorithm because we are taking so many things of this. So the time complexity and space complexity is more in case of gradient descent method. So to reduce this particular one, and also there is a disadvantage because a local minima problem comes into picture. We cannot escape a local minima. Whereas in case of when you go for the new method, that is stochastic gradient descent method. Here it is based on the online estimation. Online estimation or online weight updation. Online weight updation or online estimation. So here single input, whenever input comes, it calculates the new weight. Next input, once again it calculates the new weight. So based on each instance or each example or each data point or each sample, we are going to calculate the new weight of this. So when you are calculating the new weight of this one, as and when it is depend directly on the input, but input is a random variable. Therefore, the weights also are random variable, random in nature, and also error also is random in nature. So because of this particular one here, when you look at the in case of stochastic gradient, the error is some kind of wavery in nature. So, whereas in case of the descent method, gradient descent method, a perfect deterministic line of this particular. So here, because of this particular wavery in nature, so here the optimal solution, whatever you are going to get it is, it's not a proper optimal solution. So there may be small wavery in this kind also. So here to estimate this one, there are various methods and various algorithms. I'm not going to that topic. It's out of scope of this subject. So here, once if you get this one, this gradient, stochastic gradient descent algorithm, it is a good solution, no doubt in that, but it is not the optimal solution. Because instead of getting a small value at this point, a small that side also it is possible. Because weight itself is, input itself is wavery. But the what is the advantage in this case is, because it each one, it depends on each sample of that one. it takes less number of iterations. And also, not only less number of iterations, whenever less number of iterations, the computational complexity also is less. Well, how the computational complexity is less? Here, because for each weight updation, each input, it is some kind of on input variable it depends. So one single input is sufficient. Whereas in the previous one, matrix, big matrix is required. Maybe if there are 1,000 samples, if four features are there, 1,000 by 4 matrix size is enough required. Whereas here, only one sample at a time. So the registers or memory or whatever it is required to do this process is far, far less compared to the previous algorithm. That's why in machine learning or deep learning methods, the previous one method is not at all used. Only the upgradation or the improvement of the next algorithm of this one is used in this one, or a stochastic nature. And one more advantage when you look at this one, it can overcome local minimas also. So to overcome local minimas also, the one is how it is possible is there is some kind of concept called simulated annealing or learning schedule. So here in learning schedule and simulated annealing, we can find out what is the minimum value of learning rate and maximum value of learning rate which is required. Okay, I need not be between 0 to 1, any higher values also you can take it. You take higher values of that one. At each iteration, you can reduce the values of eta, and thereby it is possible to reduce the, one is reducing the whatever the local minimas, and second one is at each iteration by reducing the convergence parameter or the step size, that means it is we are nearing to optimized solution, because yesterday's class we have seen the difference between higher step size and lower step size. So with this particular one, it is possible to get the function. So there is in Python, there is a function SGD, regression function. Use this function and find out the values. So now when you look at what at home, what you have to try is an algorithm. Maybe Wine data set or Boston data set. You know, you do a complete process. The complete process is using a scaling of the features and using SGD regression and using various optimization, because in the SGD regression itself, it comes whether you want to use L1 norm optimization, L2 norm optimization, regularization, what is the regularization you want to use it, what is the cross-validation you want to use it, all those things it is possible in that particular one. So here like this, you can try one kind of data set and you see what all the things, that is finding out minimum maximum values. That is standard scalar function itself is available. You need not use this one. Use standard scalar function and use cross-validation, K-fold. Yesterday we have discussed. So you can divide. There are two things. One is a complete data set. You can divide into training and test. Or you can the same data set. You can use it for using cross-validation as a training set and testing set. So you can use that way also. And then calculate the root mean square error and evaluate the algorithm and using the cross validation algorithm. And in this particular one itself, you predict the values and find out the coefficients. You find out linear coefficient, gradient estimation coefficient. So when you find out the gradient coefficient estimate, so you can use the function directly or you can write a function on your own. Here the functions, it's written on its own. So here in this particular program, it is functions, or you can use already Python functions are available. You can use the functions as it is. And you find out, you try for a Boston data set and Wine data set and different any other prediction data sets and write a complete program. At least write on your own 5 complete programs. Maybe this week's assignment is that one for complete one data set. Who is going to do the best method? Whether let them write on your own, use the function. So there you have to see, you have to identify different parameters, R square and all those things, and also whether any unnecessary parameters are there, any outliers are there, any performance parameters are there, or what is the confidence, for which confidence interval you are taking it, and in that particular one, what optimizations you are using it, or what is the stochastic gradient algorithm you are using. So a complete program for a linear regression, if you complete for 3 to 4 data sets, then rest of the things is not much. Instead of linear regression, you can use some other algorithm, but whole process remains same. Is it okay? Shall I stop at this point? By this time, so many of them have gone out. Okay, thank you.